And I will use this opportunity with this topic to address the questions that we had at the end of the session last time. And several of you stayed beyond the class and we had quite a discussion. So, alaykum salam. We're going to have, inshallah, a discussion on that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has an objective in the Quran from not mentioning certain things. And that is different from what is called in the language of Fiqh, as-sukut al-tashri'i or al-farad al-tashri'i. There is something that the Fuqaha use sometimes, which is called the legislative vacuum. Like there is an area where there is vacuum in terms of the Sharia. I think from a Maqasid perspective, this is not right. Because there is no area that is left with no tashri'a, with no Sharia. But there will be a difference between two kinds of tashri'a. What we call here an ahkam, or the rules, or the stated rules, versus the rules that are not stated and should be inferred from the higher maqasid and from the maslaha and all of that. And this is the difference here between what we discussed last time, al-fiqh and al-fiqh. You know, fiqh, as in Islamic law, deals with rules that are stated. So, rules related to marriage and divorce, rules related to al-riba and the salah and the zakah and al-hajj, right? But it doesn't mean that everything about marriage and family is the rules of marriage and divorce. And everything about hajj is the rules for hajj. Because there are many other dimensions of hajj that we can think about. And not everything about architecture, as one of you in the discussion said. Yes, we cannot have an architecture where we put a cross or we... Yeah, that is true, because there is a rule, a clear rule, that, you know, there is kufr and there is iman. But there are many, many other rules of architecture that are not stated, that we should get in terms of maqasid al-sukut, the objectives of the tacit objectives, the objectives of the silence. But this silence is not vacuum. We should differentiate between these two things. And therefore, to go back to this, we are talking about two things here, because we have secularism so deep in our psyche. We are actually talking about fiqh and fiqh. The division of fiqh and fiqh is a secular division. It's the same division that we have in some Muslim countries between al-mahakim al-shar'iyya wa al-mahakim al-madaniyya. So sharia court and civil court. This is Sharia, and these, you know, French law, English law, whatever law, it doesn't matter. That is the division between fiqh and fiqh, and that is not right. Because Islam is not only about the family law and about the stated things. There are things that are stated, obviously they are at the core of Islam. Bunya al-Islam ala khams, shahadatu an la ilaha illallah wa rasulullah wa aqam al-salah wa ita'i zakat. So the five pillars, and the issues related to riba, and the issues related to marriage and divorce, and so forth, and the hudud, and the qisas, and all of that is part of Islam. But this is not just Islam. Islam is much beyond that. And therefore, what we are trying to do here is actually confusing, because we are dealing with a terminology that has been so deep in our psyche, which is the differentiation between fiqh and fiqh. And if it makes you comfortable to tell you that we are working in the area of fiqh and not in the area of fiqh, you can take that. But that, I'm telling you, is a secular argument. Because there is a rule for everything in Islam. Reminds me of a seminar we had once on medical issues and medical policy and all of that, and invited some of the fuqaha. And one of the notable ones said one of the questions is, what are the Islamic guidelines for medical policy? And then he said, this is not what Fiqh should do. This is medical policy. So I told him, okay, Sheikh, medical policy, how can we imagine? How can we define a medical policy? He said, this is the role of the government. This is not my role. I tell you about the haram and halal. Like, okay, in what sense? He said, well, medical issues, there are things related to the awra, there are things related to some of the operations. So as fuqaha, we think about them, and we tell you that this is haram and this is halal. But you want to have a policy, you want to have a hospital, or you don't want to have a hospital, it's not our job. So my argument back was, yeah, Sheikh, this is a secular opinion. Because you view that the role of Islam, which you are studying and guarding and so on, is only about the awrat. Yes, Zakallah khair. Thank you, bro. It's only about the awrat, and it's only about the halal and haram in some issues. But there is halal and haram in medical policy. But we haven't been trained to think about that. That's why we perhaps had this discussion. I enjoyed it very much and I learned from it. But it's a bit confusing because we are speaking about two different terminologies here. Some of you could tell me fiqh, and I say no, fiqh. And I mean by fiqh, fiqh and fiqh, I don't differentiate between both. Because I think that if you have a citizen in a country, and now in a nation state, the country is closed, you cannot just go out, you need visas and passports, or you need to be able to live somewhere else. The world is not open like it used to be, except for partial countries in particular, you know, restrictions. And therefore, you are in a certain country, and the polity of today goes that the people own the country. The country is for the people, right? So when you have a policy, for example, in America, where people who own one of the richest countries in the world, by the millions, they don't have health coverage, which means that they have no access to medicine, right? This is not just because, oh, too bad they are poor. This is a system that is making them poor, is making them work for a number of hours, for a certain amount of dollars, so that they survive. And then the next month they have to do the same thing. But then they need $10,000 to you know, remove a cancer, got a lot of bills or any of that, and they die. Because they don't have $10,000. That is some 20 or 50 million people. In the United States, I'm talking about one of the richest or the richest country in the world. But because how the system is done, the 1% and then the 10% and the rest of the 300 million people are living on crumbs, on small pieces of land, and they pay the time, they take loans and so forth, and you know, the American life. Is this haram? Yes, it is. Could we give a fatwa about that? Yes. I mean, it is haram. Can we have a better policy that is more Islamic, or even talking in the general sense, more just, more fair? And that's not necessarily communist or leftist. You could still be capitalist. But if you're going to judge that people could die because they don't have $1,000 to buy some medicine, in a country where you start to hear about trillionaires now. No, they're beyond millionaires, of course, and billionaires. And we're talking about trillionaires, a few of them now in the United States, which means $1 billion, you know. So why are they trillionaires? It's because of a monopoly system, right? That monopoly system is haram. Al-muhtakiru kafir. We have in the hadith, the monopolizer is a sinner. The monopolizer is not necessarily a guy who goes out in the town and buy all the goods from the camels and then bring back. This was monopoly in the previous time. Taraqqi Rukban, we call it in the fiqh. But Taraqqi Rukban is a form of monopoly that the Prophet ﷺ had forbidden because he had seen. But had he been with us today, he would say, well, every human has the right for clean water. and for the minimum amount of medicine, not necessarily very sophisticated robotic things, but a pill for $5 or $10, and the person dies because they don't have this pill. That is not Islamic. That is haram. In the areas of Sharia studies, we classify this talk I'm telling you now as Fikr Islam, the Islamic thought. And it doesn't have an implication of fatwa, halal, because I am actually just talking thought. We could talk thought from here until the morning. But when we talk fatwa, it's about the minor issues. It's about, as our scholar said, al-awrat. So yes, can a doctor see the awra of a woman or a man, and how, and this. And then he's very sure about what he's saying. But when it comes to millions of people dying because they cannot afford some basic medicine in a modern state that is very rich, but it's very monopolistic, then they say, no, this is the job of the government. We are not. That separation is wrong. And that separation is something that we are trying to mend here. That's why, bear with me when we get into issues of how can we do that? Because we have to admit that we have a crisis. The people who normally put medical policy and deal with the science and tech issues and so forth are normally educated in a secular way. And people who are supposed to deal from an Islamic point of view are educated in the sources of Islam, but not in the application of the sources on issues like that, on issues like medicine or law, on issues like the environment or the economy. And therefore, they sometimes make judgments based on premises that they don't understand. They don't understand what a digital currency is, so they just say it's haram. And there's no difference really between it and the dollar in many ways, in many economic ways, except for the fact that, you know, the dollar is printed by the United States whenever they want, which is more haram really, like if I may give some little fatwa here, you know. But you see, because now we have a state that has guns and is just printing money. And that's how it works, very simple terms. This is very problematic. And then you have some people, yes, I know it's fluctuating, and some economists could give us some opinion about that here in the Q&A. But I'm saying that sometimes the mashayikh don't understand the issue of the digital currency or the digital economics and so forth. And then the fiqh becomes lagging so much behind the world because it's making everything haram that the mashayikh don't understand. And we have a history of that from the 19th, 20th century. The radio was haram and the TV, the earth was not round. I'm talking about major scholars in Islam. Earth was not round, and it's haram people to say that, and it's haram to use a telephone because that's jinn, and we are forbidden to use jinn in communication, and all of these fatwas back in the 1920s and 30s when people did not know what this is, right? I am sure at that time the technical people who worked in these telephone lines knew technology, but I'm sure they were laughing because they were saying, no, there is no jinn, it's just electronics and so forth. So we deal today in a similar way with things that we don't understand, and we don't see that there is a maqasid of the sukut, of the silence here, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention something in clear terms in the Quran, there is a maqasid. What are the maqasid of this? This is very important. One, flexibility. So he mentioned the things that, if you wish, are for every place and time. Everywhere in the world, we're going to make wudu the same way and pray and do hajj and fasting. We have some odd cases. What if there is no water? How can I do tayammum? There is snow. How can I wash myself with snow? Whatever. Or in the North Pole, odd times for fasting. That is a very small part of this. But he did not mention, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the things that change so much. There is no talk about health policy here or medicine, because we live in a different planet today. We send a little robot to somebody's body and they do the operation, you know. That is something that, how can the Quran state that in human language that the Arabs comprehend at that time, and that people comprehend 1,000 years from now too. Because I'm sure that what we do today, 1,000 years from now, if the earth is still there, people will say, well, these people were so primitive, they were so naive, they were talking about robotics, this kind of thing. But eventually, so the technologies that change so much, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a wisdom, has a maqasid from not mentioning them, for the flexibility of dealing with that, right? According to al-maslaha, according to al-maqasid. Now, what constitutes a danger to life would be haram. A danger to al-irq, honor, dignity would be haram. A danger to offspring or family would be haram. Even if that thing that constitutes a danger to dignity or family comes 500 years from now and we don't even know what it is. Gave a khutbah recently in Canada on gaming. And it was a break somehow on Friday, so the masjid was full of young men and women. So I gave a khutbah on the forbiddance of gaming, that gaming is haram. And this was the khutbah that I had the most reaction in my life, I guess. I mean, especially from the younger ones. I had a whole crowd of them, boys and girls, after the khutbah, telling me, where did Allah say in the Quran that games are haram? And they were a very interesting debate. In the khutbah, I mentioned that not everything is haram. It's not like haram like liquor or whatever. But it's haram if it leads to addiction, because addiction will take you away from prayers, will take you away from studying. It's haram if it leads to some health hazards and so on from playing with these things. Some people lose their sight when they look at the phone in the dark. We're starting to see these things in our kids. So basically, I tried to base the fatwa that I'm giving there, that it's better to view the gaming business as haram in a particular way. And then I have very interesting discussions, but the most interesting would be like, no, this is wrong, because Allah didn't say gaming is haram in the Quran. I said he talked about al-maisir, or gambling, but this is why it's haram. It's haram because it makes you lose your money, and makes you lose your health, and makes you addicted. So we can do PS, if you're gonna talk traditional language, and on an analogy between here and there. But it's something that we need some fatwas in. Of course, it's a very generalistic fatwa that I kind of gave in this khutbah. From the perspective of cutting the roots, because I haven't seen any kid who really benefited from gaming. I mean, it really ruins their lives, and so forth. But and we are so behind in this, in the Islamic world. We don't have a game that kids could play that is Islamic, really. We have some of these simple things, you know. But it's very important that we address the issues of silence in the script with some courage, that Allah was silent not because it's left open. Not al-asl of al-ashya' al-ibaha. Yes, everything is originally lawful, but not like that. Not something that kills people as in a policy or a medicine or a game, something that is going to harm the environment. And the environment is not luxury. I mean, the earth is in a serious danger because we are not serving the environment. Every nation state is just doing what they have to do. They burn as much as they need to burn in order for the economy to grow and to make jobs and so forth. And they really can't commit to serving humanity. And therefore, we are ruining our planet. That is haram. That is, according to the Quran, ifsad of al-ard, mischief on earth. And ifsad for al-ard is not just burning a tree or cutting a palm tree, as the Quran said, مَقَطَعْتُمْ لِلِينَةٍ أَمْتَعْتُمُ. It's not only that, but it's also mischief on earth. Instead of burning one tree or cutting a big tree, as the Prophet ﷺ forbade in the hadith, we're actually burning millions of trees every day, and species are disappearing, and so forth. That is ifsad, that is mischief. And that goes under ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. Mischief has been spread in heavens and in earth and sea because of what people do. And therefore, the sukut here, the flexibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has a maqsid of rahmah, of mercy when he doesn't mention something, to keep it kind of open. Some of the details are not mentioned. In Surah Al-Baqarah, the people from the children of Israel, they insisted on the details. And the Prophet ﷺ commented on the story. He said, had they slaughtered any cow, it would have been enough for them. But because they made it difficult, Allah made it difficult for them. And humanity has a tendency to define everything properly. And except, especially if it's about paying and this and like, just slaughter a cow. No, what kind of cow and this? And towards the end, Allah said they almost did not slaughter it. After they found the very precious cow and they had to pay I don't know how much gold in order to buy that cow, they even didn't want to slaughter it at the end. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps things open sometimes. And we have a tendency to do this tahdeed or to have what's called sometimes in fiqh al-inbibat, which is preciseness. Preciseness is not always good. Sometimes preciseness is wrong. Because Allah did not want it to be precise, akhi. Yani he left it open, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do we want it to be precise? It's like the differences we have in prayers and all that. Where is the hand? The hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, his hand was here, or he was here, or he was praying with his hands down. And people quarrel over that. And then people decide to reject a hadith narrated by authentic people, because there is another hadith that is more authentic. Because they imagine that there is one form of ibadah. But there are many forms. Oh, but how can I pray like that and he prays like that? That is fine, that is Islam. How can I, you know, fast today and he doesn't fast? Well, he has a different opinion. That is all right. Why not? This is Islam. Well, unless, alhamdulillah, I have an authority somehow that defines Ramadan, khalas, then people should be united, obviously. But if there is no authority and we are traveling and I think it's Eid tomorrow and you don't think it's Eid tomorrow, so what? We have different readings. One is calculating according to the first matla, and one is calculating according to the local matla. And we think differently. Why do we imagine that it's always muhaddad, it's always precise? That is also from Maqasid al-Sukut, the diversity of the ummah, the flexibility. That is part of the nature of this fiqh. But we tend to lose that. But in the madhab so-and-so, it is very precise. Yes, because the madhab used to be a law. The madhab, the book of the madhab would go to the court and would be the law, the serious law that is applied to the people. So it has to be precise by the quarters and the halves and this and that. But when you live Islam, not in a court, outside the court, in family or whatever, family is different. You would have different wills according to different families. I have a will and my brother has a different will or sister or uncle. That is fine. Why? Because this particular child is disadvantaged or she needs something more. I give a will for that child or mother or الأقربين والوالدين والأقربين والمعروف حقا على المتقين. It doesn't have to be. But this mentality of precision led us to employ or utilize a small part of Islam, and we left the rest. We consider it abrogated or whatever, or not narrated accurately. There are so many accurate narrations that are implying things that are different from the mainstream, and so many leeway in many things, right? But we don't. We want it's just one way of doing things, and one school. And all the other schools are wrong. And therefore, at some point in our history, we have those four mihrabs, because every school of the four Sunni schools, anyway, has to pray behind a different imam and a different way. Like, why? We're all Muslims. And Sunni, for that matter. Like, very particular way of sources in Islam and so on. And of course, the Shia mosques would be different, and the Ibadi, and this and that. And we have all of these divisions, and people are divided because they insist on the precision of it. And they don't agree on a minimum level of principles. If we agree that we don't defame the Sahaba, we don't curse them, some of them could be right, some of them could be wrong. That is in every madhab. You see, but we don't curse them. We don't curse any of them, except for the munafiqun, of course. Sure, we agree on that. That's a common denominator. We don't have to, we agree that Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers, are all at a high status in Islam. Yeah, some of them made political mistakes. Yeah, obviously, yes. I mean, they themselves admitted, Aisha radiallahu anha, but she is somebody very special in Islam. So can we reach a common, flexible, kind of open-minded ground? No, we can't. Because we insist on that everything is mentioned, and then we twist the verses and the hadith to support my particular madhab and my particular philosophical choice in the kalam, in the aqidah, philosophy, not aqidah, the real aqidah. There's no difference between Muslims, but the philosophy of aqidah. And we choose. So, but if we look at this, maqasid al-sukut, the maqsid of silence, that Allah left things open, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for us to interpret in different ways, and philosophies differ, and so forth. So that Islam is wide and flexible. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned here, al-ma'ruf, mata'an bil-ma'ruf. Ma'ruf, what is customary? That's different between South Africa and Arabia, between China and America. Yes, that is fine, because Muslims are diverse. That's why al-ma'ruf is like that, is left. خُذْ الْعَفْوَ وَأَمْرُ بِالْعُرْفِ. Many, many ma'rufs in the Quran, and they are stated. Because al-urf, the custom, is not just the names of fish and meat, and like what we study in Fiqh. It's a very, very small, tiny part of al-urf. But the rest of al-urf is things that people do, customs of the people. And as long as they don't contradict with the principles of Islam, then they are acceptable. If they contradict, yeah, then we start to debate, you see. Even though, as I mentioned a couple lectures ago, that some of the customs that the nations inherited from before Islam, every nation on earth that became Muslim, they still have some of the customs from before, and they removed some elements, or they don't think about these pharaonic gods anymore, but they still do the stuff that the pharaohs used to do in some occasions, because it's just humanity. They like symbols, they like to see colors and whatever and ornaments and so forth, but as long as they're not going to do shirk, because how can you live a life that is void of customs? You can't. And if you are going to adopt the customs of Arabia, then this is a political statement. This is not Islamic or anything. That Arabia is Muslim and Catholic. It's just everybody, you see. So this is what I wanted to say. Now, next, in the Maqasid journey with the Quran, and these are highlights. Of course, up under this, there is a lot of details that I'm just giving an introduction. As I mentioned, the objective here is to survey the Maqasid of the Quran, and therefore go from that to dealing with disciplines and seeing how can we apply these principles in different disciplines and so forth to create some sort of a new thought or a new fiqh and so forth. So now another technical chapter has to do with a surah, maqasid al-surah. Every surah has objectives that are different from the topics of the surah. You see, there is a mixture in our history of tafsir between al-maqasid and al-aghrad. Some scholars mix that. Al-aghrad, gharad al-surah, means the topic of the surah. Yeah, if we can bring that volume down just a little bit, because I feel that it's... So al-aghrad, thank you, brother. Al-aghrad are the topics of the surah. So every surah has a number of topics based on the paragraphs of that surah. But these paragraphs, we should look at the objectives of these paragraphs. And yes, you will find in every surah certain objectives that the surah is trying to achieve. on an individual level, on a community level. Like, for example, if you take Surah Al-Baqarah, it's huge, it's the biggest surah, and it's divided in very, very diverse ways. The best tafsir of that has to do with the Maqasid of the surah is the tafsir that's done by Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah Draz, rahimahullah, of Al-Azhar, of decades ago, 20th century, called the Naba' al-Azim. He wrote a book on the tafsir of Al-Baqarah. He was saying that Surah Al-Baqarah is not fragmented. It's actually like a very nice dress, he's saying, that has different parts, and every part has a particular pattern and a color. But the whole dress makes sense. So you have a paragraph on a story, and then laws, and then another story, and then different laws, and then the hereafter, and then Musa, and then the Nasara, Ahl Kitab, and then Dua. But you see, it's not haphazard. And he explained beautifully what we can call a systematic approach to the surah. The book translated in English, Naba'ul Azim, the great news, or the great news, I think, or the great proof. You will find it, Draz, D-R-A-Z, for those in English, and of course in Arabic, Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah Draz. If you look at that, he did an analysis of the surah in terms of what the surah is trying to achieve. And he is saying that the primary maqsid of the surah is the organization of the new society in Medina. That's in terms of the time of the Prophet ﷺ, how to organize a society. So from the beginning to the end, it's talking about the different types of people, believers and disbelievers and munafiqun. And it's talking about a large number of legislations, tashri'at, for the family, for the debts, for the riba, for this, for so many things. But they form the legislative core, if you wish, of a new society. And then it's giving a number of stories that have an objective of teaching the new community. So the stories of Bani Israel, the children of Israel, so that the new community does not fall in the same faults that they fell in. And it follows the things that they did right, for those who did right things from the children of Israel. So it gives you from Ya Bani Israel Azkuru Ni'mati, and then it goes back to the law, and then back to Bani Israel, and back to the law, and back to Bani Israel. Because it's actually giving you lessons from their lives. It's not just a story. And then other stories of Ibrahim and, you know, the other Anbiya and so forth, for the sake of the same purpose of standing with truth against power and insisting on Kalimat al-Tawheed and so forth. And then it doesn't leave all of this without some dua at the end. And Allah knows what's in your hearts and so on. رَبَّنَا تُأَخِذْنَا نَسِينَا وَخَطَأَنَا. And it does address riba, or usury in very particular ways. And then address debts, and takes the debts as an example. Actually, that is also from the sukut of the surah. The surah talked about debts, but you can make an analogy or projection between the debts and any other policy that you would like to have, any other legal policy that you'd like to have. So why did the surah get into the nitty-gritty details of the debt, a whole page in an average mushaf, a whole page, 20 lines, 25 lines, just on one ayah, which is ayah today, the longest ayah in the Quran, the ayah of debts. And it's getting into the details. And if the person who is indebted cannot write, then somebody else writes. And then if he's called for witnessing, then so on so. Why? To give an example, it's not just that Islam is only organizing debts, and everything else is not organized, free-for-all, capitalist kind of thing. No, it's organizing that in a way that we as a society could organize other things in the same way. Now we organize, you know, the city and laws, and you take a piece of land and use it and whatever, and so forth. You see, different kind of organization. So the surah has a maqsid, even though it's the longest surah, and it goes in ajza, several juz from the Quran, but it has one end kind of thing that is trying to form a society. That is the scholar's view that Sheikh Raz, for example, presented. And it's, to me, one of the most mature that I've read on that tafsir of the Surah Al-Baqarah. So the smaller ones, it's clearer, because the objectives would be much clearer. Like Surah Al-Ikhlas, Qul Allah Ahad Allah Samad. This is about Tawheed. It's clear. And Tawheedullah means to believe that He is one, unique, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that He doesn't beget or begot or any of these things do not apply to Him, and there is nothing like Him, and so forth. So, one maqsid. Some surahs have kind of two stories, but with one maqsid. If you look at Al-Imran, after Al-Baqarah, you will find that the part of the surah is dealing with the people of the book. And then the other part is dealing with Uhud, with the battle of Uhud. And it's only those two topics. The people of the book and everything from Alif Lam Mim, Allah la ilaha illa huwa al-qayyum, all the way to وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ تُبَوِّئُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَقَعْدَ الْقِتَالِ, about the middle of the surah, all the way to the end. Now, these are not two topics just gathered in one chapter. They aim at a common goal. The Ahl al-Kitab lessons are for the Ummah to learn not to fall in the Aqidah mistakes that they made, and not to follow the corrupt priests that they had similarly, and so forth. And then the second half is a lesson from the reality of fighting for the sake of truth and so forth, and if we are going to seek the affairs of this world, and we leave the Prophet calling us for the truth, and we go and look for the spoils of war, and this doesn't apply only for these kinds of wars, it applies in everywhere, it applies in our life as Muslims. When we do not understand the fight and the eternal conflict between truth and falsehood, between the justice and injustice. It's you know, this is the nature of life. And therefore, both lessons would help us to form an identity that is the inheritance of the people of the book and whatever they inherited from Islam that reached us now. Now Islam is defined in a new and final way. And when we deal with our battles and so on, if we are truthful, we should know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't bring anything evil, and that our defeat will be a beginning of a new victory and so forth. And then towards the end, it brings the people of the book again. But it doesn't leave you like that. It also puts in the reflection. There are signs for those who believe, and so forth. So it doesn't, as I mentioned, doesn't go like a human book, chapter 1 and chapter 2 and conclusion, but within there is a lot, in order to serve a particular maqsid. If we look at the surahs this way, we have a very different reading of the Quran, because it's not going to be fragmented into the verses and half verses. When we used to memorize, the Shaykh would test us, you know. The Shaykh would start from the middle of, not just the verse, the middle of the word sometimes, you know, in order to see if you're good memory with the Quran or not. And that is quite a fragmentation here. Like I never, like that Shaykh, Allah Alhamdulillah, he never sat with us and say, okay, this surah, in order to memorize it well, Surah Al-Kahf, this surah is actually four stories. The story of the people of the cave, and then the next story is the story of the two men, and then Musa and Al-Khadr, and then the Qarnayn, okay? And then between the first story and the second, he never did that. He just, okay, you know, my son, read, yalla. And then we read. So it's very fragmented. It's just a verse after verse. And jazallah khairan, that's how we traditionally memorize. But it does make a big difference if you look at the surah as blocks and as something that is serving an objective. And then you see, okay, what kind of objective do we serve? This is the surah serving, and how can, so that when you forget, you remember. Oh yeah, actually, yeah, I remember, because now it's now the fourth surah. So yeah, not just words that you memorize and sounds, it is actually a meaning and better objectives. If you can see that, for example, Surah Al-Kahf, Al-Iman was manifested in four different ways in that surah. Belief, the way of people who are on the run because of their Iman. And then people who are friends and are at par. Iman and Kufr, disbelief and belief, is actually having a conversation in the second surah. And then the third surah, Iman is learning. You know, Musa was the prophet of the time, but he had to learn that he doesn't know everything and that there is somebody else who's going to teach him. And that person is going to do some guerrilla operations that are not exactly what you typically do, but and so forth. So Iman in a peculiar kind of state, and therefore has to learn certain things. And then fourth, Iman as a king who is a believer and is ruling and is making deals in order to protect the weak and so forth. So here are four different forms of Iman. And you read them every Friday, and whatever state you're in, wherever life takes you, one of those will apply, whether you live in a society where you have disbelievers for friends, or and you are talking about belief, or you are on the run, and you remember that, yes, Allah will give you victory with something that you never imagined, or you are somebody in power, and you have to know that you have to be fair and you have to be just, etc., etc., and so forth. So the resembling paragraphs and the resemblances in the surahs and all of that, they have a wisdom. And to look at the maqasid of the surah and the objective will allow you to memorize the surah better and read it better and learn from it in a more informed way at a higher level, like paragraphs and so on. Now, the language of the Quran as well has its own maqasid, and this is going to be a bit more, as I said, technical. If we look at the maqasid of at-tawheed, and we look at al-wahid, al-ahad, everything that has to do with wahada, the root, we will find a web of relationships between the different forms of the word wahada, or the jazr, the root wahada. But if you take al-huda, if you take as-salah, it gets much more complicated, because salah or salaha would be salihun, muslihun, islah. There will be a number of concepts that are tied to that objective of islah or reform or betterment, and a number of forms and ways and lessons and so on tied to this. So an analysis here is to look for the language, is to look for the maqsid, and then abstract the maqsid in its root, the Arabic root, and then look for the root. Alhamdulillah, there is software today that could do that, that could analyze and bring you any variation of these roots. And when you look at, for example, taqwa, taqwa has the root of waqa. Waqa is to protect from something or to shield from something. But it is manifested in many ways. So التقوى المتقون and واتقوا الله إلا تتقوا منهم تقى. A number of forms there. As you can see here, an analysis I did with the program called Zikr, Z-E-K-R. Use it if you're interested in this. Very interesting. You'll find 258 instances of waqa. And then if you look at that, you will start to do some sort of a linguistic analysis of the maqsid, of the taqwa, and to understand the different sides of it and the different dimensions of it. Many people do that only, but this should be part of the bigger maqasid analysis that I'm presenting here. But I'm aware of a large number of research recently, now with the software and Arabic judur in the software, that people just analyze, you know, the word waqa in, okay, here they are, and that's it. But the important thing here is to combine this and to look for what you are looking for. The taqwa is a huge concept. It's not a, you can write a whole PhD on this. This is, but if you are a person who is looking for example, one of you was discussing with me the issue of money and wealth and property and so on. So look for al-mal, al-mal is not money. Mal is money in the colloquial language, but mal in Arabic, ma-li, ma huwa li, you know, what is the ownership, really, mal, amwal, are the properties and so forth. And then you look for al-mulk, you know, al-mulk is not necessarily kingdom, but malaka yamliku, is to own, is to have, وإذ قال موسى قومي يا قوم اذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ جعل فيكم أنبياء وجعلكم ملوكا. So not all of them were kings, but they were own owners. They you know, they own property, they have power, and so forth. So if you look, for example, for al-mulk and see how al-mulk is dealt with in the Quran. But mulk by itself is not enough. You could look for other related words to malaka yamliku, and then you will see a great deal of that. I wouldn't get into that. But then if you look into the hadith of the Prophet with the same waqa, ittaqillaha haythuma kunt, and so forth, you will see other dimensions of taqwa that the Prophet is explaining in the hadith, because this is the hadith job. And we will get to that in one big discussion, inshallah. About the hadith, explaining the Quran, really. This is the job of the Prophet ﷺ. Now, al-husn, al-husn or the beauty, we have theories of art in Islam, or theories of beauty, or aesthetic, philosophical discourses, to speak a modern language, in Islam, that do not look at al-husn. But al-husn is the heart of that in Islam. And actually, beauty in Islam is not just material beauty. And when you say aesthetics, you mean the objects, the ornaments, the, you know, the colors, the what you can see. But beauty in Islam is actually in the meaning before it is in the material. So al-husn, al-ihsan, is how to worship Allah is in the excellent way. You know, this is the highest level of beauty in Islam. المحسنين إن نراك من المحسنين سنزيد المحسنين. المحسن is somebody who gives charity in a very basic sense, but also somebody who prays at night. إنهم كانوا قبل ذلك محسنين كانوا قليلا من الليل ما يرجعون بالأسحار وهم يستغفرون. Prays at night and does istighfar before Fajr, and they give charity and so forth. And then you find الإحسان وأداء إليه بإحسان. You're going to give what you are going to give, the money or the compensation or whatever the verse is mentioning, in ihsan, in beauty. So you are actually paying for something, but you are paying in beauty. And you are forgiving in beauty. And you are, like, so many forms of beauty that the Quran is giving us in order to form a theory, a whole theory of aesthetics, but beyond the material meaning of aesthetic, when you say aesthetics, right? فَإِمْسَاكُمْ بَمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ. A beautiful divorce. So you see, divorce is normally ugly. But Islam wants people, if they reach that, and Allah forbid they're going to get a divorce, at least it's a beautiful divorce. So that is part of the beauty theory in Islam. تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ. And so forth. And of course, the word حَسَنَة, when you do a good deed, it's the same thing. You're doing not, hasana is not a dollar or a rand. Hasana is actually a beautiful addition. It's, you know, and sayyi'ah is something ugly. It's not, you know, a material loss. The word salaha, as I mentioned, salihat, salihun, fa'aslaha, qul islahu lahum khayr. The reform in Islam is a comprehensive theory. And al-islah is not reform, because reform, that is usually the translation, but reform is to reconstruct or to rebuild, but al-islah is to transfer something from al-fasad to salah, from mischief to welfare, to beauty as well, to good. You know, islah is betterment, really, more than reform. Or conciliation, or all of these meanings are actually islah. وصلح خير وحضرة الأنفس شرح الله talked about conciliation as the same word, الصلح, to conciliate. فأصلحوا بينهما, when two people fight, they conciliate between them in good. Now, it's not just betterment, it's really make them in peace, in serious, real peace between each other. But then if one of them does badly or injustice, then fight the injustice, and so forth. So it's quite a concept, quite a maqsid here actually, al-islah or salaha. Al-ilm is a whole different story in the Quran. Al-ilm is not information only, and knowledge and you know, science. And we translate al-ilm in many funny ways, but al-ilm alma ya'lamu. Al-ilm has to do with all the formations, the linguistic formations of al-ilm. First ayah al-fatiha, al-alamin, al-alam. Al-alam is from al-ilm. Al-alama, or the sign, is from al-ilm. Al-ulama, the scholars in English, but in Arabic, al-ulama means somebody with knowledge. That's why the translation of scholars means somebody who has a degree from a particular university. But that's not necessarily a scholar. That is a scholar in Islam, but a scholar could have no degree, but has ilm, ilm, ulama. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِي عُلَمَاءَ Allah, those who fear Allah the most are the knowledgeable ones. Not the ulama necessarily who, you know, wear something necessarily. Because Allah mentioned this, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the context of the natural sciences. He wasn't talking about fiqh, subhanahu wa ta'ala, or anyway, he was talking about al-ard and the kinds of colors in the mountains and so on. And then he said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ Those who navigate the earth and look at the earth and sea and look at the types of rocks and the type, they will fear Allah, of course, if they have belief. If they are disbelievers, we had some very high-level scientists in our time that did not believe in Allah, so they did not have a fear from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if the scientist, for lack of a better word, or a scholar, or academic, or alim, let's put it in the Quranic terms, if they have iman, then their ilm will add to their fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their respect, and so forth. They will not take it as, you know, a game for material gain. They will be sincere and they will have integrity and so forth. And then, علم آدم الأسماء كلها. Part of the ilm is the asma. And we're going to discuss concepts next. Al-asma, or the meanings, the names. The names is a big deal in Islam, because we have to give the right names to the right things. And we have a war of definitions, sometimes, all the time, in fact. But especially in our time, we have a war of definitions between different philosophies and so on, and Islam. And we're trying to define good and chastity and benefit and whatever, richness, in a certain way that is not Islamic. And Islam has a very particular way of defining things. So part of that ilm is the asma, is the names. And the asma have a sultan, have an authority by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning them in a certain way, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explaining them in a certain way. Sultan al-asma, ma anzallahu biha min sultan. Then Al-Alim is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is Al-Alim, the knower, or the knowledgeable one, the, like, you know, the all-encompassing. But then our little ilm is a small part. لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ مِدَادًا لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي Kalimat is another word that's used for al-ilm. That the words of Allah, if they were, the oceans were to be ink, then the words of Allah would never end if we are going to use all of this ink, even if we bring another ocean, and so forth.
So al-ilm in the Quran, if you're an educator or if you are somebody who's interested in knowledge, has ways of learning, and has ways of teaching, and has particular features. And al-ilm, if you are going to do this exercise, you will start to form your own theory, or if you wish, or your own understanding of how ilm is actually taught and received and so forth. Beyond the experimental logic, that is a small part of ilm, not going against it, but going against it being a criteria for knowledge. Knowledge is much, much wider. Ilm is much wider than science, really. Ilm, we translate it as science in the Arabic language, but that is a very poor translation, because science means experiments and labs and academia and so forth, and that is economics, you know, that's a very small part of it, technology and so forth. Al-ilm is much wider, and some ilm is from Allah by a gift. You see, Allah gifts people with different capacities and capabilities. Some people look at a person and then they know so much about him. It's nothing magic, it's just ilm. It's more ability to see into a situation or a person or a phenomena. Somebody has a much more refined understanding than somebody else. That is a gift from Allah, and we're all like that. You know, a little kid could tell you something that you never thought about, even though they are 5 or 7, but they can see something because they were gifted with a certain observation and so forth. Al-ilm has quite a different concept, and if we are going to be into education, several of you are into education, we have to be careful with how the Quran and how Islam talks about al-ilm, because we cannot just bring the textbook from any other country, developed country, and then put the textbook in the hands of our child, even if it's math or science, and expect them to have an Islamic view on that. We have to be able to critique this knowledge, and we have to be able to bring the Quranic perspective on these things that the children are learning. To go on with the objectives of the Quran, this is also a bit more of a specialized topic that has to do with the Quranic readings. The Prophet ﷺ was from Quraysh, and Quraysh talked Arabic in a particular way. But Arabia, even at his time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had different dialects and different emphasis on different techniques in the Arabic language. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not want to sound only Qurayshi when he speaks to all the other Arabs. It's like the Arabs today, they diverted even more in their language, you know, but sometimes they don't understand each other, you know. And Iraqi would not understand the Moroccan unless they are used to the Moroccan accent, and so forth. So the Prophet ﷺ asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him ahruf, to give him different dialects of the Quran. And he, in the hadith, had asked for ahruf until he was given 7 of them. What are these 7? We don't know exactly, the different interpretations, but let's say the 7 different variations of any Arabic word or sentence. Like, there are different expressions and different ways. And sometimes the variation is not in the word itself, but it's in the diacritics of the word. And that makes a big difference. For example, the first example here, وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابِ. Be Rabbaniyin, be Lordish or God-fearing, or it's difficult to translate in English, Rabbani. Rabbani is somebody who is related to Allah. Men and women of God, let's say, Rabbaniyin, that would be a good, I guess, translation in English. Why? بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابَ, by the way of teaching the book, وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرِسُونَ, and by studying, you know, الْعِلْمِ, بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ. There are different readings here. تُعَلِّمُونَ is to teach, and تَعَلَّمُونَ is to learn, and تَعْلَمُونَ is to know. And the Prophet ﷺ read the 3 of them. So we have dozens of narrations. not just, this is not odd narrations. I'm not talking about odd narrations now. These are the, what's called the qira'at al-mashkura, mutawatira. You know, there are tens, dozens of people who narrated after each other that the Prophet ﷺ read it like that. بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعَلَّمُونَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Why? Because here is a theory of knowledge. Knowledge is not just to teach, but you cannot be a good teacher if you are not a good student. So تُعَلِّمُونَ, to teach, تَعَلَّمُونَ is to learn. And تَعْلَمُونَ is to know. So you have to know and teach and learn. That is why you have different qira'at here. And Hafs and Wash and so forth, what we know today of the imams who translated the qira'ats to us, the readings to us, now we know them by these names. They have different ahruf in different ways. So it's not like the dialect number one is Hafs and dialect number two is Wash and dialect number three is Qalb. It's not like that. Every narrator has actually a mixture of things. And the original dialect of Man of Allah, and we told the people who are writing the Mus'haf, the original one, the default one, is Quraysh. Quraysh's dialect. But even in the most famous ones that we have today, it's not exactly Quraysh. Like, for example, Quraysh doesn't have a Hamza. The Hamza is very light in the Quraysh dialect. And it's closer to the Warsh reading. أنطلق كيف فعل ربك بعاد إلى مذات الإماء وفرعون ذي الأوتاد, not ذي الأوتاد. The Awtad is not exactly how Quraysh reads. Quraysh gives a very light consideration of Al-Hamza, and it appears in Warsh and in some other readings. Are there Maqasid for that? Yes. At that time, the Prophet ﷺ was concerned about the rest of the Arabs understanding the message. So that's why he kept this open window of reading in different sounds and different... I'm not sure if you are familiar with the different qira'at, but if you read the different qira'at, you will hear different sounds, because Arabs actually speak in different ways. And he added even to that sometimes dialects that are rare, like in the hadith, when some people came from a tribe that replaces the lam with the meem. He actually replaced the lam with the meem for them. Those who are into the hadith would know ليس من بر صيام في السفر. So ليس من البر الصيام في السفر. So he turned every lamb into a meme. It's like the Egyptians who turned the G into a Ga, and you know, the Yemenis turned the Qa into Ga too, and so forth. And, you know, the Ghain, the Sudanese, the, or, you know, people. I don't divide people with these nation states, but let's say in Egypt, in the south, they say Al-Gha, Al-Quran. They don't say Al-Quran. It's not allowed anymore, because now we are just going to go by the dialects that the Prophet ﷺ had read. But sometimes the meaning is different. Like, for example, Allah الذي خلقكم من ضعف. ضعف is weakness, is total weakness. But Arabs use another word that means physical weakness only, which is ضعف. So there is ضعف and there is ضعف. These are two words that Arabs use. Like in today's Arab world, some of them say ضعف and some of them say ضعف. But actually the original Arabic, ضعف is weakness in everything. But then ضعف is, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that people, when they get old, sometimes they are weak in their body, but not in their minds. But sometimes their minds and their body wear out. So that's why there is ضعف and there is ضعف in the qira'at. There are sometimes a med or an extended vowel, extended sound, for the sake of stressing a particular meaning. Like some qira'at, when it comes to la ilaha illallah, they have to do a very long alif here, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّهُ. You have to do that, even if you are reading the quick version or the al-hadr or and so forth. إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدْنِي, and so forth. And sometimes in some other verses, there are some reading for the same reason. For example, the verse لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ, there is a mad here, which is no compulsion in matters of faith. Why there is a mad? Because this is important, to stress on it. So if you're going to say in English, there is no compulsion in the mad, something like that. And it's funny that some people consider this to be mansukh or abrogated, even though in terms of qira'at, it's confirmed. There is a mad there, and there is nothing in the Arabic language that is more strong than saying there is no compulsion in matters of faith. La ikraha fi deen. You see, in the usual qira'at, you could say la ikraha fi deen, or you could say la ikraha fi deen. But according to Hamza, for example, in this example, there is a ta'zim wal nafi, to make the nafi confirmed and stressed and great. For example, a sect. This is also in some of the qira'at. Basically, alif lam mim. So some of the qira'at would say alif lam mim, like they would give a, in order to stress as well, the a'ma and a'mi. I'm just giving random examples. For example, the ayah in Surah Taha that says, وَمَنْ كَانَ فِي هَذِهِ أَعْمَى فَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ أَعْمَى وَأَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا. Whoever is blind here, then in the hereafter, they will be blind and more lost, right? A'ma and a'ma. You will find that some of the qira'at saying, وَمَنْ كَانَ فِي هَذِهِ أَعْمَى فَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ أَعْمَى وَأَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا. So, a'mi, the difference between a and a, like it's more of a slanted alif. And this has to do with differentiating it from the alif for a particular objective. So, وَمَنْ كَانَ فِي هَذِهِ أَعْمَى means that person is blind. فَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ أَعْمَى, more blind. So would be a'ma is blind and a'ma is more blind. It's like alim and a'lam, more alim. So we say alim and a'lam. Here is a'ma and a'ma. So in order to differentiate and to stress the meaning of, you know, the more blindness, as I mentioned, this is quite technical, but I thought that this could be part of the outlook on Maqasid, if this is your specialization there. Bismillah majreha wa mursaha. In Surah Hud, when Nuh sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said majreha, normally it's majraha, the ship, the course of the ship. But the course of the ship was called majreha instead of majraha, so that it's actually going very smoothly. There is smoothness. It says al-imala lis-suhula. This slanted alif is to give an impression that it was very easy and they did not struggle in the ship. قَالَ رَكَبُوا بِسْمِ اللَّهِ مَجْرَيْهَا وَمُرْسَاهَا الْمُخْلَصِينَ الْمُخْلَصِينَ إِنَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا الْمُخْلَصِينَ. In Surah Yusuf, he is amongst the chosen one. If you change the lam مخلصين into مخلصين, it would be the sincere ones, to show you that the sincere are the chosen and the chosen are the sincere. So some qira'at would read al-mukhlisin, innahu min ibadina al-mukhlisin. He was one of the sincere ones, not just chosen randomly, but he was chosen because he was sincere. وَمَنْ أَوْفَى مَعَ هَذَا عَلَيْهُ اللَّهَ فَسَيُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Surah Al-Fatih. Some of the qira'at would read عَلَيْهِ اللَّهَ, the normal qira'at. But Hafs, for example, say عَلَيْهُ اللَّهَ. Why? Because when you say عَلَيْهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come in a light way afterwards, will be عَلَيْهِ اللَّهِ. But if you say عَلَيْهُ اللَّهِ, it will be more stressed. So that the covenant, he's talking about the covenant. So that's why the sound is stressed, عَلَيْهُ اللَّهِ, so that it's stressed. وَيَخْلُدِ فِيهِ مُهَانَ. In Surah Al-Furqan, it's also the punishment is stressed by this, not يَخْلُدِ فِيهِ مُهَانَ, that the adulterers will spend their time in the fire with humiliation. So with the humiliation, it's actually giving another mad. وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاقَ, for example, just to give a few more examples. In Surah Qiyamah, وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاقَ, like there is a sect or a silent pause. And there is a pause for apprehension, for a waiting that they will wait. Who is going to rise and who is going to fall? وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاقٍ كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ. When Allah says that the sins will cover the heart, and then He is saying كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ. Nay, the sins will cover the heart. So there is kind of a pause there, so that when you stop at will, like will what, and then cover the heart, more or less in English. So it gives an attention to and so forth. So many examples that we could cite. So the difference is even in the qira'at between how the Prophet ﷺ himself read different times, actually have an objective of stressing a certain meaning, going with a particular context, and so forth. And that is part of the nature of the Quran and the Arabic language. Arabic is not English. Arabic, and is not Latin. Arabic is one of the oldest languages, in fact, that we have today, perhaps changed over the centuries or the millennia. But it's one of the oldest. The older languages are not aiming to precision necessarily. So the language itself, it doesn't have to be precise. You can say al-mukhlasin, sincere, al-mukhlasin, the chosen one. And it doesn't matter, it's the same. Well, one implies the other. So that is fine. But if you speak Latin, you would say, okay, are they chosen or they're sincere? And chosen by whom and for what? This kind of, the language itself is very precise, the Latin languages. And they are precise because they are used for the practical life. They are not used for the higher meanings. They are, no insult for English or French or any of these languages. But Arabic precision is not necessary because the flexibility of the meaning is meant and is systematic. The flexibility of the meaning never takes the meaning to its opposite. It never does. You will read with a different dialect. You have a slightly different meaning, but it will never be the opposite of the meaning. It doesn't go like that, because the structure of the language itself. And in fact, the words themselves, the word has a meaning. And if you go the opposite order of the letters, you will have the opposite meaning. And you have a number of this in the Quran. Kataba means to kataba is not just to write, and it's actually kataba is used for writing, because when you write you tie the meaning to the paper. But kataba Allahu la'aghlibanna ana wa rusuli. Allah wrote, He didn't write, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He ordained, He decided, kataba Allahu la'aghlibanna, I will be victorious. Kutiba alaykum al-qisasu fil qatla. The qisas or the revenge is actually maktub, kutiba alaykum, because it is tied to you. Kataba is tied. Bataka is actually the opposite of kataba. So kataba, bataka is actually to sever the ties. So kataba is to tie and bataka is to sever the tie. There are many Arabic expressions that are like that. The language itself is structured down to the meaning of the basic root. The shaitan said in the Quran that I will ask them to cut or sever the ears of the cattle. He used the word bataka. Opposite to kataba, and so forth. And I could go to some books and give you more examples. So many examples of that. And the Quran is full of that, because the Quran, when it chooses a word, it could choose an opposite meaning by just flipping the word itself elsewhere, so that the meaning is the rightly the opposite meaning. Now, the odd readings are different from the Ahruf. Al-Ahruf are ways when the Prophet ﷺ asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to speak the Quran in different dialects so that different Arabs understand. Those who say A, E, they could understand. Those who say you know, sarata, tarata, they don't understand. But the odd readings are Sahaba who thought that the Quran is read this way, and they mixed the original text with a tafsir of it. And therefore, they add a word here or there, or they have a different, quite a different reading sometimes. But the Sahaba, the way they decided is to obey by the collective decision. When they were gathering the Quran, they would write the common that all the Sahaba agree on, but not write what they called al-mansukh, or the abrogated. I don't believe in this theory. I don't think that they were abrogated. I think they were interpretations that were added, but then they were corrected eventually. You know, some of the Sahaba thought, because when you look at the ahadith of the abrogation, they are funny. I mean, the hadith, for example, where there was the Quran written on a piece of leather, and then a chicken came in and ate the leather, so therefore it was abrogated. Some of these hadith are funny. Yes, I know they are in the authentic collections. I'm going to have some good discussion on the authentic collections. But some of this doesn't make sense. According, not just to me, according to many scholars, you know, what is that? You know, the goats or the chicken, they came in and they ate it, so it's no longer there. What? No? Do we write the Quran like that? Of course not. It's not like that. There was a whole process, and the Sahaba had corrected each other, and it was a whole process. And we have the product now, six copies. We have five or six of them, and you can look at them in Istanbul and Cairo and so forth, and the exact copy is the same copy. So the Sahaba did not, you know, something is lost, okay, let's leave it. It's too light. So they call these the odd narrations. So for example, in Abbas, لَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جَنَاحٌ أَن تَبْتَغُوا فَضْلًا مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. He said, لَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جَنَاحٌ فِي مَوَاسِمِ الْحَجِّ أَن تَبْتَغُوا فَضْلًا مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. So he added in the season of pilgrimage. That is an addition from his perspective for tafsir, or maybe he read it this way, but he was wrong, even though he was a habar, he was like a whole alim in the Quran. But the rest of the companions said, no, we're not going to take this, because it's only Ibn Abbas who reads it this way. The rest of the companions. Ibn Abbas, the Prophet died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was 12 or 14. So he was young anyway. He would only bring him the water for the qiyam, and he would only, you know, bring him the things to ride. But he would serve him, but he was not a companion in the sense of learning. He was still a child, not very young. Aisha, when she said, حَفِظُوا عَلَى الصَّلَوَاتِ وَالصَّلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى وَصَلَاةِ الْعَصْرِ وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ, she added وَصَلَاةِ الْعَصْرِ there, and she said that this is something she heard from the Prophet ﷺ, but the rest of the companions said no, the صَلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى is صَلَاةِ الْعَصْرِ, but she was adding her own understanding. خَمْسُ رَضَعَاتٍ مَعْلُمَاتٍ يُحَرِّمْ, she said that of the Lana, Aisha of the Lana, there was in the Quran five known breastfeeds entail forbiddance. So she said that this was part of the Quran, and then she didn't think that they were removed either. But Ufa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Quran. She said, he died, and I would read this as part of the Quran. So the objective here is actually to understand why we have these odd readings. There are many, actually. There is a book, Qira'at al-Shahada. Some people compiled, some of the scholars, compiled the Qira'at al-Shahada. And you look at, so there are many of them, most of them are very small, not a word or two like that. But this is not for the objective of diversity here. It's for tafsir. So we should read them as a hadith, really, as the scholars take them. That if a companion says that the Quran is saying this, then it's actually a hadith that the companion is narrating. Now, to look at, I will take something quickly, and then I will stop at the end of objectives, inshallah. To look at the objectives of the eloquence, That is also another technical lesson that I think would also be useful for an introduction. Some of our brothers and sisters last time stressed the importance of knowing the language. And yes, if you are going to extract things from the language, then you have to acquaint yourself very well with the Arabic language. Arabic is not a race. Arabic in Islam is a language. And where Rasulullah said, إِنَّمَا الْعَرَبِيَّةُ لِسَانٍ. And to be an Arab is to have an Arab tongue. So those of you who speak Arab here, I consider them to be Arab. Because alhamdulillah, I'm not racist. I don't differentiate between races. And those are from Ya'rab or Qahtan or Adnan or Quraysh. This is like just Arabs. And some of them don't speak Arabic. You know, some people I have seen in Arabia don't speak Arabic because they are Americanized or whatever. So those who speak Arabic are Arabs. So if you are going to get yourself, you have to be Arabized in that sense. You have to Arabize yourself. And إِنَّمَا الْعَرَبِيَّةُ لِسَانٍ. If your tongue becomes Arab, then you are Arab. Arabs divide eloquence into three meanings. Al-ma'ani, wal-bayan, wal-badiya. So basically, in English, that would be the linguistic patterns and the illustration patterns and the expressive beauty patterns. There are certain ways of expressing a certain eloquence through the language composition. You know that when you study Arabic, there is mubtada and there is khabar. So you start with the mubtada, there are two words, could form a sentence. Muhammad, tayyib. Muhammad is kind. So, but then if you flip that, if you say tayyibun Muhammad, that is also Arabic. But why do you bring the khabar before the mubtada? Is to stress the khabar. It should come at the end, but we are bringing it at the very beginning of the sentence in order to make it more stressed. So if you say Muhammad Tayyib, Muhammad is kind. But if you say Tayyibun Muhammad, Muhammad is very kind. You see, Jameelun Hada, this is very beautiful. Instead of saying Hada Jameel, this is beautiful. You see, in English it would be the same, but you don't say beautiful, this is. Oh, well, we say beautiful, it is, for example. So something of that sort. Arabic is full of that for the khabar and the insha and the taqdeem and the ta'khir and the injaz. And itmar, so basically the abbreviation, the omission, the alteration of the place, the traditional place in the sentence. And the Quran is full of that because the Quran is very expressive in the Arabic language. So if you are versed in this language and you read with that eye, like for example, Zamakhshari, is if you are an Arabic reader, you have to have your readings of Zamakhshari because he, as a mufassir, is one of the greatest in that particular eloquence analysis. So he would tell you this is first before this, so that to stress that meaning. There are maqasid, there are objectives of the eloquence structures that the Quran uses. Now, al-bayan, or the illustration and images, there are, we call them in English, metaphor and similes and so forth. In Arabic, they are similar, like al-tashbih, al-istiara, al-kinaya, and so forth, and they have their objectives. And then there's something in Arabic that's called al-badiya, or the expressive beauty. So basically, for the language to be beautiful, so it's correct. There is nothing altered about it to achieve anything. But there are certain ways of expressing beauty, and I'll give some examples. And part of al-balagha is actually ahkam al-tilawa, or the recitation rules. I mentioned some of the qira'at of the other dialects, but the recitation rules themselves have their maqasid too. So for example, al-haf, or the omission, very obvious is the omission in stories. So as I mentioned, transferring from a scene to a different scene. They are dealing with Yusuf, and all of a sudden the camera is on his father. And whatever is there, and then back to Yusuf, and then back to this. That omission of the scenes and letting you imagine the scenes in between is actually not just on the scene level, but on the sentence level. Like in the sentences, you will find so many things that are omitted for you to imagine. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا. And when they come, that's it. Full stop. Like if you can translate in English, in Surah Az-Zumar, when they come to Al-Jannah, And when they arrive there, full stop, and then the doors will be opened, and then what will happen when they arrive there is actually mahdoof, is omitted. So that you imagine what will happen when they arrive to Jannah. It's not حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا. This is for Nar. When they arrive, the doors will be open. Yes, this is جواب الشرط, or this is the rest of the sentence. But in Zumar, when it talks about the Jannah, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا, that's it. This is the sentence. And the rest of it is mahdoof, is actually omitted, so that you imagine. إِنْ يَنْتَهُمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُمْ مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ وَإِنْ يَعُودُوا فَقَدْ مَرَّتْ سُنَّةُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. If they stop, Allah will forgive the past. And if they come back, no answer. And then the universal law of Allah is going to be always applied. So it's not وَإِنْ يَعُودُوا, something will happen. So it's actually omitted and replaced with a universal law. So if they stop their aggression, then they will يُغْفَرْ لَهُمْ مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ, they will be forgiven. And if they don't stop, then Allah's universal law will apply. This is how we translate in English. But in Arabic, it's actually an incomplete sentence to let you imagine what will happen to them. But then sometimes, فَقَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نَاقَةَ اللَّهِ وَسُقِيَهَا. In Surah Shams, the Messenger of Allah told them the she-camel that belongs to Allah and the water that comes with it. This is the literal translation of it. So it's not, do not kill the she-camel or do not transgress against it and make sure that the water is not spoiled. It's not saying anything. It's saying the camel and the water. That's it. But that's from the eloquence of it. So that you can imagine what he told them and the debate they had. But Allah's replacing this with three words. So that the camel and the water. That's it. فَقُلْنَا اضْرِبُوهُ بَعْضِهَا كَذَلِكَ يُحْيِي اللَّهُ الْمَوْتَى. Then in Surah Al-Baqarah, after they slaughtered the cow, Allah told them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, then hit that murdered man with it. That is how Allah will resurrect the dead. It doesn't say that he was resurrected and then he said who killed him, so they went and arrested the murderer and so forth. There's a whole story that you see in the Bible, for example. It's the Bible. The Bible is like the Hadith, really. The Bible is different. It's the narrations of those. And it's Hadith daif. It's not really, like if you really look at the Hadith standards, no offense, but if you look at the Hadith standards, the Bible wouldn't hold the level of authentic as we have in the Sunnah sciences. But in the Bible there are so many details. But the Quran comes from a different perspective. This is not a human story. It's just giving you the touches that you need. That's it. They ended up slaughtering the cow, and that is how Allah resurrects the dead. That's it. The rest of the story you can imagine. It doesn't matter really whether the man confessed or didn't confess or any of that or what they did with him. It doesn't matter. It's not the rationale of the story. That's why it was omitted. The rationale of the story is the part that was not omitted when they went back and forth with the Prophet, tell us what's the color and tell us if it's a male or female and whatever and this and that. And all of that, they gave them a hard time because they were asking too many questions and they were addicted to details and to the material part of the law. And that is quite a feature of their law. The story of the man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made to die for 100 years, to sleep for 100 years, and then he came back. So after the rest of the paragraph, وَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ, and also look at your donkey. So you see towards the end of the story that, oh yeah, he actually had his donkey with him. And the donkey actually died with, but the donkey died and the man slept. وَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ, just look at your donkey. And that's it. It doesn't say anything about the donkey for the rest of the story. Because it's abbreviating, it's just giving us a hint that actually there's so much to the story. It's not as you think. It's not as simple as that. There was a donkey involved, and so forth. And so forth. So I don't want to get into that too much. But then the metaphors. The metaphors in the Quran gives you a big question whether these are real meanings or metaphorical meanings. Some scholars said there is no metaphor in the Quran. There is no majaz, you know, there's a big debate between the Asha'ira and the Salafiyya and all of that. But the debate, I mean, the point behind it is that some people say when Allah said, وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا, we put a barrier between them and you, O Muhammad. There is a barrier. Some people say, well, no, there was no barrier. This is a metaphor for them not understanding him. But some others say, no, there was a barrier, but we don't understand the structure of that barrier. Perhaps a barrier in the, not in the meaning sense, but in some other sense that we don't understand. So the people who insisted on every word in the Quran that does not make material sense are the usual Salafiyya, the Salafiyya in the old, you know, not the political group today. I mean the old Salafiyya, the school that insisted on the letter of the Quran. So Allah said there is a barrier, there is a barrier. Allah said there is something in their ears, they can't hear you. There is actually something in their ears, but we don't see it. Allah said that they are giving you the bay'ah, Allah's hand is above their hand, then he has a hand and he has an eye. And so they took everything literally. The Asha'ira or the others, and especially the Mu'tazila, were more rational. They said, no, these are all metaphors. And the debate went on, it became political at some point, and so forth. But if you look at the metaphors, they are actually very interesting. Because you wonder sometimes whether this is real or not. But Allah said, for one example, ثُمَّ تَلِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Their skin will be soft with the Qur'an. And whether really when you are comfortable with something, your skin becomes healthier. Actually, this is now science. It's telling us that when you are happy and comfortable, your skin becomes fine and your wrinkle, you know, slower, or I don't know. So when Allah says that the Quran will soften their skins, the Salafiyya said, yes, their skins will be soft. And the others said, no, this is a metaphor for them being comfortable, being happy with it. And so forth. The rest, the Quran has a lot of that. Including اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, the straight path. They say, yeah, there is a straight path and we are going in it. And some people say, no, it's a metaphor. There's no road that we take. Because they think materially and the other one think nominally. And the truth is probably neither in the material or the nominal philosophy, but that's, you know, something for us to think about. Al-Iltifat is actually an incredible example of al-badi'a, or the expressive beauty in the Quran, is to talk about something and then to divert the talk to something else and then go back to what you are talking about. Like, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَوْمَ يَجْمَعَ اللَّهُ الرُّسُلَ فَيَقُولُ مَاذَا أُجِبْتُمْ قَالُوا لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ عَلَمُ الْغُيُوبِ. Allah will bring the Rusul, the prophets, and he will ask them, and so on. And they would say, you knew everything. And then, that's it. There is a diversion from the hereafter to the story of Jesus. وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى ابْنُ مَرْيَمَ اذكر نعمتي عليك وعلى والدتك إذ أيدتك بروح القدس تكلم الناس في المهد وكهلا. So that's the story of Jesus. And then after a page it says وإذ قال الله يا عيسى ابن مريم أنت قلت للناس اتخذوني وأمي إلهين. It's actually the continuation of what was said a page ago. But it diverted. It's telling you in the hereafter Allah will bring the prophets. And then he will ask Jesus, did you tell people to worship me and my mother? And he said, no. But before him asking Jesus, he's telling you the story of Jesus, actually, in two pages, a page and a half. So that you go to the story first, and then he's telling you, okay, we were talking a bit about the hereafter, let's go back to the hereafter. Allah will ask him then, did you tell the people so-and-so? And then it goes, and so forth. The Quran is full of that, the linguistic diversion, the iltifat. Iltifat al-ma'nawi, you know, there are two kinds of iltifat or diversion. The iltifat from al-ghaib al-mukhatab, alhamdulillah, rahim, rahman, rahim, iyaka na'budu, iyaka nasta'in. This is iltifat, traditionally speaking, with the linguists. that you're talking about Allah, and then you're talking to him, and then you're talking about him, and you're talking to him, and so forth. But the iltifat al-ma'nawi, or the, I would say the wider linguistic diversion, or the linguistic diversion of the meaning, is actually a lot in the Quran. The Quran has something called at-tadhyir. At-tadhyir is to have a tail for the verse. What is this tail? There is something, and then it says, Wallahu sami'un alim. Wallahu ghafurun rahim. Inna Allah kana ghafurun rahim. Inna Allah kana. This, they call this in Arabic the tail of, it's not the general body of the story. But why? Why every time there is something mentioned, then it says, and Allah is all forgiving. And Allah, yeah, exactly. So it brings you the attribute that is relevant for the story. So it doesn't, that's why one of the Bedouins who heard the Quran the first time, he heard, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَاقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا. Those who are thieves, male or female, then cut their hand or their fingers or whatever it is. اَقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِنَ اللَّهِ. And this is a punishment from Allah. And then the reader said, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And Allah is all forgiving. He said, no, no, it doesn't go like that. Because when you have a comment on a punishment, if Allah is Ghafoor Rahim, he wouldn't ask us to cut his hand. So they went back, and yes, it was wrong, and it's actually Allah, Azizun Hakim. Allah is almighty and wise. And so forth. So the tadhyir actually has a very big meaning. If you look only at the tadhyir, you will see a lot of that. And sometimes the tadhyir is for teaching us according to the attributes of Allah. وَلِعَفُوا وَلِيَصَّحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ. So Allah is forgiving, you also forgive as He is forgiving. And so forth. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَفُوًا قَدِيرًا. The other verse talking about forgiving, He is telling us He is forgiving, but He is also very capable. So if you are capable of punishing somebody, remember that Allah is forgiving and capable. It's not just forgiving out of weakness, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so forth. I mentioned the objectives of the vocational rules of the recitation and so on. And therefore, if we take the objectives and look at the objectives of the other usul, and I stop here, and the concepts, the values, the universal laws, and the rules, the shari'i rules, and the logic, and we're going to get into that next time when we're going to have a Q&A now. But basically, if you look at beyond the objectives, you look at the concepts and the universal values and so forth, and you start to build that web of meaning of the Quran. It is a tafsir mawdu'i, it is a thematic interpretation, but it's if you wish, a thematic interpretation. It's an interpretation that takes you to particular ways of reading the Quran, so that you are looking for particular meanings that, inshallah, will benefit you. I will stop here now. This is the end of this Maqasid al-Quran. Yeah, this would be the web. It's just a graphic of that. I didn't build that or anything so far. Just dreaming about it so far. But this is basically the web of meanings that you could have as a resource for people who are looking for the objectives of the Quran. So Q&A, and or we can take a break and then